no, 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 baby, no, 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 don't lie.
Hey, Dan here from Sigma Dogs, and I have a little bit of a controversial video or set of videos. This is going to be part one of two because it might be a little bit longer. Video's basically going to be about how the two camps in dog training often indulge in lies to sell their product. You know, I stand highly opposed to people doing this, regardless of, you know, which training camp they belong to. I'm one of those people that thinks you should just tell it how it is. And in most cases, the truth isn't that bad. I guess some would lump me into the balance trainer camp in that I use prong collars and e-collars, and I use even more positive reinforcement. The first group of trainers that I'm referring to as the pure positive group, they basically, you know, again, I'm speaking of the extremists where they think you can only reward your dog and correcting a dog, you know, is some great sin. And they're often very outspoken about it, and they go to great details to attack people that don't believe in our ideology. And those people, those extremists certainly exist in the balanced camp also. I've seen this over the years. So first of all, I think the old adage is true, where the only thing that two dog trainers will agree upon is that the third is wrong. And here's an example of that.
Katie, you are the man. Whatever you whispered into Galaxy's ears worked. I love the interaction with you and Galaxy and how it worked and how you had Galaxy wait so the dogs could catch up. I think Galaxy did a phenomenal job. Move over, Caesar Milan.
I have to step in there because I believe that any trainer or owner who uses a dominance submission methodology, that's medieval dog training. The best scientists and ethologists and behaviorists in this country agree that to train your dog in a positive manner gives it confidence and security.
Yeah, but it's not your way or the highway. He has his way of training,
what?
And that's
no,
your
no,
way
no,
of training.
No, 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 no. I totally disagree. I totally disagree with
you're
you.
You're not the end-all
totally.
Be-all. Everyone has
I
their
totally
own way of training.
With you.
What, you
Science.
Think you're the god of dog
Science.
Training?
Science, yes, I am, because I follow the very best in this country.
I mean, this
I'm not
is just ridiculous.
Do you know what? Do not say I'm ridiculous, and I'm going to get very angry with you.
I didn't say you were.
No.
I said
well,
this is ridiculous.
You are saying that I am ridiculous.
Well, get over yourself.
I'm sorry. That is very insulting.
Okay, well, that was amusing. So I guess the thing that bugs me the most about the pure positive trainer is that they sell their clients on this idea that if you repeat an exercise enough times, it'll become pattern behavior and you can totally eliminate the reward. I guess the underlying part that bothers me is you're basically assuming that a dog is stupid, right? And that really bothers me. So imagine you work somewhere for 10 years and then all of a sudden they stop paying you. Now, if it's not a job that you didn't really enjoy, you're not going to go continue to work for free. You think a dog's really that different? You know, the definition of obedience is doing something you don't want to do. So if it took a food reward to get your dog to sit or down or go to place or anything else, and you do it a whole bunch of times and he's doing it because he's getting paid, and then all of a sudden you stop paying him, you think that he's going to keep doing that for the rest of his life? You know, I think that's a little bit of a stretch. So here's the bigger part that bothers me about that. There's probably people that buy into this. They do thousands of repetitions with their dog. They now think their dog's bomb-proof. Maybe they go somewhere off-leash, and because the training in the hall worked all the time, they think their dog will come back to them every time that they call, and potentially it could lead to the dog's death. You know, that to me you know, is criminal, that you were sold this idea. Now, trust me, there's lots of e-collar trainers that do the same thing. I'm sorry, but there are dogs where, you know, there is an e-collar made that's going to stop them. And again, I could tell some horror stories, but, you know, these lies need to stop because they're dangerous to dogs and they're dangerous to an unknowing public. So the next part, I guess, that really bothers me is this group of pure positive trainers would like you to believe that they don't indulge in anything that's punishing or uncomfortable to the dog. Well, if typically the dog that performs very well has either a high prey or food drive. So let's take food drive for example. You potentially might have a dog that was genetically born that thinks he's starving all the time. You're basically telling the dog, hey, if you want your starvation to stop, perform this exercise and I'm going to help you end that starvation. You know, I don't think, you know, that can be described as being super kind. You know, if there was somebody dying of thirst in the desert and you say, do this and I'll give you a little bit of water, you know, does that really make you a kind person? There's lots of things that the pure positive trainers do where they're in fact doing negative reinforcement. They're causing discomfort until a behavior is performed. And then, you know, that discomfort ends. Here's a video to illustrate that.
In the full version of this clip, Gene Donaldson admits that what she's doing is negative reinforcement. The key thing you have to remember, though, is that Ian Dunbar and Gene Donaldson have been huge crusaders for the pure positive movement, and they've made a fortune doing it by giving seminars and courses and you name it, preaching this holier-than-thou message.
I personally hate gentle leaders. There isn't anything gentle about them. The dogs that I typically see on gentle leaders look miserable. I have all kinds of people coming here with dogs on prong collars, and none of them look miserable like that. And if they did, I would certainly get them off that piece of equipment. You know, just because a piece of equipment is approved by your camp doesn't give you license to ignore the obvious. So, to me, that's just extremely hypocritical. So the next bone of contention is if negative reinforcement or causing discomfort until a behavior is performed was this terrible, terrible thing, why do we have alarm clocks? Why do we have seatbelt chimes? You know, alarm clock basically administers a very low level of torture to you until you get up and shut it off and you get out of bed. You know, it makes an annoying sound until you finally get up. A seatbelt chime is the same thing. It's going to keep annoying you until you put your seatbelt on. Now, again, I don't have any numbers or anything to prove it, but I'm sure seatbelts do save lives. And I'm sure that there are more people that put on seatbelts because they get annoyed by that chime. There's lots of people that would have the best of intentions to put on the seatbelt, but they would simply forget. And in some cases, because somebody put on a seatbelt on a particular day, it saved their life. Now, if you don't believe in any form of punishment, I guess you don't believe in the administration of speeding tickets and such either. With speeding, somebody would argue, well, Dan, there's speeding tickets, but people still speed. Yes, but there's also a point system. After you lose so many points, you'll lose your license. Then the argument becomes, well, there's people that drive without a license to speed. Well, inevitably, if that behavior continues, they're going to end up in jail and they won't be able to indulge in speeding. So therefore, the system has reduced speeding by one method or another. Most reasonable people, after they get a few tickets, they do slow down. I think it's that simple. Life is sometimes about, not everything in life is nice. And, if you take the life of the average human, you go through school, you got to get a job, you get the job, and then maybe you don't even like the job, but you got to keep a roof over your head. Then if you get fired, now all of a sudden you lose the roof over your head. Maybe you don't have anything to eat. Your life becomes miserable, right? It's that threat of punishment and discomfort that makes you go to your job every day. It makes you get there on time. It makes you do well enough that they keep you. And I don't think a life without stress is a good or enjoyable life either. You know, overcoming challenges in life and adversity and all of these things, that's what makes us proud. That's what builds character. You know, I don't think a dog should be any different. Now, let me get on to the final point. So there are some very reasonable, trainers that use positive reinforcement only, and they'll tell their clients, well, make sure you don't let your dog off leash because something bad could happen to them. And, you know, I don't have any qualms with those sorts of trainers because they're not going to encourage their client to do dangerous things. And ultimately, that's what it is about for me. But at the same time, you know, if these tools like e-collars and such allow a person to let their dog run in a field and go off leash, to me, that's a much better life for a dog. A dog's not meant, was never supposed to be tethered to us night and day and not have any freedom and not be able to run and play and those sorts of things. So I really wish the people that are heavily embedded in the pure positive or reward only based camp that they would maybe consider that, you know, the people on the other side of the fence, they're not all bad people. Most of them aren't bad people. Maybe they just want their dog to have a better life. So again, pure positive trainers, I'm not making this video to, simply bash you. I'm going to be as hard on the balanced trainers, if not harder. I would just like for people to, again, not to turn this into a debate in the comment section or anything. I really don't want to do that. I'm just asking that people try to see the other side of the fence and have a little bit of understanding. I do appreciate that the positive reinforcement community, that they're often more well-read. They tend to have some understanding of psychology, whereas the balance trainer community, oh boy, there's a lot of individuals that have a lot of work to do. But here's the thing, positive reinforcement only trainers, you don't get to cherry pick your science. Look at the sum total of it. Consider everything that's said. Don't just take the parts that you like out for the purpose of some debate. This shouldn't be about debating. This should be about training dogs and giving dogs a better life. Observe the natural world. Observe that when dogs play, sometimes they're rough with each other, even to the point of drawing blood. A lot of dogs with their human owners enjoy rough housing. And, you know, maybe there's some bumps and bruises sometimes. But again, that's all part of life. Just try to give that some thought. Let's, on both sides of the fence, try to cut down on the hate, the vitriol, and the venom. You know, that sort of thing has to stop. And please, you know, positive reinforcement trainers, don't go out and try to ban tools before you understand how those tools work. And please understand that, you know, I do not in any way support training that is, inhumane or anything like that. I've been very vocal in the past about trainers that I think have taken a very dark path and are doing things that are somewhat unethical. So again, try to build bridges. That's it for part one of this video, and hopefully I'll see you in part two.